Good morning and welcome to the 30th meeting of the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee in 2023. I've received apologies from Emma Harper and James Dornan will be joining us as a substitute. The first item on our agenda is to decide whether to take items 5 to 8 in private. Are members agreed? Thank you. The second item on our agenda is an evidence session with the Minister for Public Health and Women's Health on the National Health Service General Dental Services Miscellaneous Amendment Scotland Regulations 2023. And for this morning's session, I welcome to the meeting Jenny Mintel, Minister for Public Health and Women's Health, Tom Ferris, Chief Dental Officer, Ailsa Garland, Principal Legal Officer, and Tim McDonnell, Director of Primary Care, Scottish Government, and invite the Minister to make a brief opening statement.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, and thank you for the opportunity to speak about these negative procedure dental regulations. As you've noted, I am supported today by my senior policy officials, Tom Ferris and Tim McDonnell, and legal official Ailsa Garland. If I may, I'd like to talk briefly through the purpose of the regulations as well as the changes we will be making as part of these. As you will be aware, the Scottish Government has been working on NHS dental payment reform for some time now. In my letter to the committee of 18th October, I outlined the key components and benefits of the new payment system, which will be implemented in just over a week, and I will be happy to take any questions on this during the session. In relation to the regulations, however, a number of key changes are required to various existing regulations to support payment reform. Under these changes, we are introducing a single capitation arrangement for all patients, regardless of age, and all treatment items, where clinically appropriate, will now be available for both adult and child patients. We're also making some changes to support unregistered patients. The system known as occasional treatment, where unregistered patients can only receive a reduced set of care and treatment, will be removed through the amendments made by these regulations. This means that both registered and unregistered patients are able to access the same comprehensive range of treatments, removing what may be construed as a two-tiered system of care. These changes also focus on bringing clinical practice up to date. The new single capitation arrangement will rest on managing the oral health of the patient, replacing the requirement to secure and maintain the oral health of the patient. The more achievable aim of managing oral health recognises that self-care is an important determinant in successful oral health outcomes. I can confirm that the equality impact assessment for these regulations report no significant issues, and the business regulatory impact assessment reports no adverse consequences. In summary, these regulations are part of the significant work we have undertaken to prepare for the implementation of payment reform on the 1st of November 2023. These changes will support the introduction of the most significant reform to NHS dentistry in a number of years. And it is our intention that this will help sustain and improve patient access to NHS dental services for the long term. I'm happy now to take any questions from the committee.
Thank you very much, Minister, for your statement. Can I ask how you intend to evaluate and monitor the effect of the impact of this payment reform?
Yes, thank you for your question, Convener, and it's something that we've been very clear about when we started discussions a number of months ago with the BDA specifically and more widely dentists within Scotland. And that work will start once the system is bedded in. We've already started having some very well attended webinars to ensure that the dentists understand what the changes are and how they will implement them within their practice. But you're right, the review is something that we will constantly keep in mind. Tom Ferris meets very regularly with dentists, whether through the NHS boards and the directors of dentistry, but also the BDA. And it's something we've been very clear with the BDA that we want to work together with them to ensure this is the right start for the reforms that we are looking at.
Thank you for that answer. You've mentioned the BDA there on a couple of occasions during your answer. According to them, their criticism was that you didn't consider any new models of care or alternative delivery models as part of the payment reform. Can you comment on why Scottish Government didn't do that?
Yes, thank you, Convener. And yes, I'm aware in my conversations with the BDA that that's something that they've been speaking to me about as well. What we have in Scotland is a blended method, and that is a combination of a capitation payment for the number of people that are in your practice. And one of the changes in the regulations is now that adults and children will be treated to the same fee now, which I think is positive, but also a payment on the actual services that the dentists provide. And I think that method works very well for the variety of dental organisations and businesses that we have within Scotland. In fact, just yesterday, Tom Ferris met with some academics that I referenced in my letter to the committee of the 18th of October, and they are very supportive of a combined method of paying for our NHS dentistry. They think that's the right way. And what we've been very clear about is that we're building on a foundation that we already have within Scotland that works very well, that practices are built on. And I think the reformed blended message is the right way that we should be moving forward. In that meeting, Tom Ferris discussed the possibility of changing within Scotland, and the advice that we got from the academics who were from North America, from Europe, from Australia, was if you looked at how dentist services worked across the world, a simple lift and shift would not necessarily provide a better service. And their view was strongly that we should be modernising a system that is already working, and that's what the Scottish Government has endeavoured to do with the changes that we're making through these regulations and payment reform.
Thank you, Minister. Sandish Gohani.
Thank you. I'll just declare my interest as a registered NHS GP. Minister, thank you for coming. Has any analysis been done on how much the average person, the average patient who is eligible to pay and not for any free prescriptions will pay extra?
Thank you for your question. I think the problem is that there isn't an average patient, and everyone in Scotland comes as an individual to see their NHS dentist. What we've endeavoured to do in this, and I'm sure you're the same as me, the letters that I've been getting is about access to service. And that's what people are really pushing for, is they want to ensure that we improve the access to NHS dentistry. And as I've said earlier, it is that sustainability of service that we are really aiming to achieve with these changes in regulations and fee structures.
Tess White.
Thank you, Convener. Thank you for coming today. In terms of consideration of other reforms, Minister, was there any consideration made to any other reforms? The current model is focused on a disease-centred piecework, so looking at preventative rather than disease-centred.
So I thank Tess White for that question. I think what we are looking at is also a preventative centred dental care service. And if we look at Child Smile, the importance of rolling that out for young children to improve their oral health, I don't think that is disease centred. I think that is very much preventative centred. And I think the other thing we are very clear on is, and I go back to the same point, it's the sustainability and the ability to access dental services that I think are really important. And the change that we made with regard to unregistered patients as well, I think that's important because, again, that moves us into the preventative space as well. So there, I think there are the regulations when you bring them all together, really show that we are wanting to ensure that there is sustainable access to NHS dental staff for, sorry, dental services for the people of Scotland.
Thank you. And in terms of reform, if you look at the schools, the places, the university places for graduates have sort of flatlined, and those graduates who do qualify tend to, they don't want to go into NHS because of the, basically, it's because of the funding model. Do you think this new model will help attract graduates to the profession?
Thank you for that follow-up question. I think, as we know, through the pandemic, we lost one cohort of dental students, which is about 160, which is about 5% of the workforce. What I'm really pleased to report and be able to let the committee know, and I think I referenced this, may have referenced this in my letter as well, is that there's 183 dental students going through dental training this year, which I think is incredibly positive. With regard to the point that you made around dental students not wanting to move into NHS dentistry, that I know that you or the COVID Recovery Committee took that evidence. However, evidence that we've had, the Scottish Government's had and officials have had, don't actually show that there are many, many students that do want to go into the NHS, and that because it gives them such a fantastic training base. And I know my own practice on Isla is one that supports trainees to come in and experience working in a rural practice, which again gives you a wide range of training opportunities to put into practice what you've learnt.
Thank you. So that's attracting for training, but in terms of the reforms, will they actually help retain the bloodletting from dentistry?
So that is the intention of the reforms, is to ensure that we continue to make NHS dentistry attractive to dentists.
And just one final question. In terms of, Minister, you talk about the single capitation arrangement. So what difference will the single capitation arrangement make to patient access and treatment options? And also, how will you assess the impact of this change?
So as I've referenced earlier to the convener's question, we will be working very closely with the dentists to ensure and get a note of and recognition of how these changes have improved accessibility and sustainability of the service. So that's an ongoing piece of work once it's bedded in.
Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, convener. Thanks to the panel for coming today, and to the Minister in particular. The changes coming in the 1st of November have caused some confusion and concern amongst patients, which has been communicated to us. So what support is the Scottish Government providing dentists to respond to an influx of concern and inquiries? And also, what public messaging and information is being provided to assure people that this change is nothing to be overly concerned about?
I thank Mr. Sweeney for the question, and it's something that we have been very aware of in the planning for this this change, which will happen next week. So as I referenced earlier, my officials have been having a number of webinars with dentists to explain the new regulations and the way of working. These have been, from as I understand it, extremely well appreciated and extremely well attended. I think there was about 1,000 at the first meeting and that webinar, and that was actually oversubscribed. So as a result, there's another one being held tomorrow evening as well, to ensure that dentists are across. And we're also doing ones on specific subjects like periodontistry as well, to ensure that it's widely known across the profession. And feedback has been incredibly positive. So I would like to thank my officials for the work that they have put into this, because I appreciate how important it is for the professionals to absolutely understand the changes that we are making. And with regard to public messaging, yes, you're absolutely right. In fact, I walked past a dentist in Glasgow the other day and I thought, oh my goodness, they've got their poster out early, but it was a different poster. So we are doing a variety of public engagement and messaging, whether it is posters in dental practices, local libraries and such like, but also a multimedia campaign as well. So it will be on the radio and other multimedia outlets. So I think we've got, I hope we've got everything covered, but we will clearly be evaluating that as we go on.
Okay. There is an issue around preventative care, which is mentioned in the policy note, and it is concerning that the drumbeat for a routine checkup will slip from 6 monthly to yearly. What modelling have you undertaken to assure the impact on overall oral health in the population?
Yeah, thank you for that question. And I know that is something that has been commented on in the media. The year-long, every year review is in depth and actually follows the NICE guidelines. But I think what's really important for everyone to understand is that it is for the dentist to make the decision based on the patient. I referenced to Dr. Gulhani that there isn't an average patient. And I think it's important to recognise that if your dentist feels that you need to be seen more regularly, then he or she has that ability to choose that. I know I was disappointed when I was at the dentist to be told that I had to come back in 6 months because I thought I was looking after my teeth health pretty well. And so I was hoping for a 9 month one. But it really is focused on the patient. And that's what these regulations give us the opportunity to. And I'm sure Mr. Sweeney, reflecting on this, if you were in another area of the health service and you were told, actually, you don't need to come back in 6 months, it's actually 9 months, that would be seen as good news. And I think that's what we've got to remember as well. So it's really based on the patient and the clinical expertise of the dentist as to the regularity of callback.
Okay. Just also wanted to raise a concern that the British Dental Association had raised about potential for widening or being sufficient to narrow inequalities. And certainly from my own experience of trying to get an appointment for a checkup recently in my own practice, which is probably one of the poorer districts of Glasgow, very difficult because the sort of permanent dentist has left the practice and they're dealing with locums at the moment. If the change of wording from securing and maintaining a patient's health to managing it could be seen to place more onus on the patient, you know how difficult it is when appointments are cancelled and so on to then rebook it, and potentially that could slip. This could potentially be even more complex when people have poor mental health, chaotic lifestyles, etc. Have the Scottish Government anticipated this risk and what plans and measures have been taken to mitigate it?
So thank you for that question. And I think, as you will have seen in the BDA response to the regulations, the letter that you wrote to them, they said that this was actually something that they had been looking for. The managing is what they feel is the right level, because as individuals, we do have a level of responsibility to look after our own health. And I take on board the point that you make about access. And I think if I can just underline yet again, that is what we have sought to improve as a result of these payment reforms that we will be putting in place next week.
Okay, thank you.
Senator Gulhani.
Thank you. Minister, you, in the previous answer you gave to me, spoke of improved access to dental services. And with the BDA warning that the SNP were overseeing the end of NHS dentistry in Scotland, are you confident and will you guarantee that these reforms will lead to an improvement in access for patients?
I have been in this role long enough and as an elected person to know that it's very difficult to guarantee anything in this life. We know what we have done based on discussions with the dental practitioners in Scotland, taking cognizance of academic research that I referenced earlier, that we believe that this is the right change at this time to ensure access is maintained for NHS dentistry in Scotland.
So access is maintained, not improved?
No, the intention is also to improve access, and that's what we've been very clear, to improve the sustainability and the access of NHS dentistry in Scotland.
So to be clear, you think these will improve access for patients?
That is my hope.
Okay. And so one of the big issues that dentists talk to me about when it comes to accessing for patients who want to register is the lifetime registration of a patient. They say when a patient hasn't engaged with a practice for between 3 and 5 years, they feel that they should be able to take that patient off the list to allow space for other people to come on board because they're full. But they say that it's far too difficult to do this. So will you be looking to make what seem like perfectly reasonable reforms and changes when it comes to lifetime registration?
I thank Dr. Galhani for that question. And as I've said, we have been very clear that we will have continual discussions with the BDA with regards to the payment reform that we have introduced.
So this is payment reform, this is lifetime registration of a patient?
I specifically said that this was payment reform because that's what we're here talking about just now. We have constant meetings with the BDA and other dentists, and I think everything is always on the table when we are in discussion with them.
But you're the one who brought it up, Minister, about improved access, and that's what you said at one of the first questions I asked you. So this would improve access, according to dentists that come to see me. What's the plans when it comes to domiciliary visits to improve access for patients who are unable to go to a practice?
Yes, if you don't mind, I'll pass on to Tom Ferris with regards to that question.
So we have a programme of extended duty dentists whose main focus is going to care homes, and we hope to extend that. It was in abeyance over the pandemic, and we hope to extend that. There is, we're having further discussions with that group of dentists to ensure that the November the 1st reforms actually help them to fulfil that purpose, and those discussions are ongoing. But we are absolutely focused on ensuring that people who are resident in care homes have access, as well as other citizens, to NHS dentistry.
But last question. So this is ongoing, but this isn't part of the reforms that have been brought in to improve access to domiciliary visits?
No, most care homes are either seen by the Public Dental Service, which is the board-managed dental service, or they're seen by these enhanced skill GDPs. And that focus, I would prefer if it was enhanced skill GDPs that took responsibility for that, because it frees up the PDS to do other work for other vulnerable groups in the community. So our focus is about making sure that GDPs feel that working in an enhanced skill environment in a care home is worth their while, and those are ongoing at the moment. It's part of the reform, and we're trying to ensure that it works. We're having a conversation with them specifically to say, this is what's on offer, does this seem as if it's working for you? And that's, we've had one meeting already, there's another one in the diary.
Thank you.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, and good morning, panels. Bad feedback. Don't know why that was. We've talked already about the shift in language and people taking responsibility for their own oral health care. How will the government support those on low or no incomes to do so?
For her question, the government has a number of ways that it supports people on low incomes. I think between 20 and 25% of adults in Scotland don't have to pay for their NHS treatment. And also the fact that we have the free examination is important as well. And I think highlighting earlier as well, other initiatives like Child Smile for getting younger children into the habit of cleaning their teeth has been incredibly helpful. And we've just actually had statistics out today which shows that from the primary 7 age group, I better get this correct, Thank you, Tim. The oral health of Primary 7 school children show that 82% of Primary 7 children have no obvious decay. So that level of, I think, backs up the investment that we have put in the preventative side of health, oral health care for children.
Thanks, Minister. We know that there's an issue with stalling registrations for very young children, 0 to 2, which are 25% lower since the pandemic. Obviously, there seems to be a lag in areas of higher deprivation. And how can these reforms be carried out in a way that minimises health inequalities? How are we going to get on top of that?
I think that's a really important question to raise. And I think if I can just say broadly, what we are intending with these reforms is that we maintain that access for NHS dentistry across Scotland. And I'll hand over to Tom Ferris.
Okay, thank you. So I suppose registration for 0 to 2 year olds is the lowest cohort and always has been, and it takes particular initiatives to make sure we improve it. And that was primarily through the Child Smell programme that was in abeyance over the pandemic and has only just really got back up to strength. So I would see those figures beginning to improve over the next few months and years. But we shouldn't be complacent. It's a very difficult thing if you're a parent with a young child to actually think, oh, there's another thing I have to do and go get my child registered. So the Child Smell teams, both in nurseries and from practices, kind of work in coordination to make it as seamless and as easy as possible. But it has always traditionally been lower. But you're right, it's lower than it has been before, but Child Smell should make the difference again.
OK. Thank you.
Gillian Mackay.
Thanks, Convener. The BDA are concerned that certain aspects of the new Determination 1 may result in unintended consequences, which may result in an increase to oral health inequalities. For example, a single examination fee which doesn't take account of disease experience may favour patients with minimal past dental disease or minimal current dental disease. Do you share these concerns, and how will any unintended consequences be monitored?
I thank Gillian Mackay for the question. I think what I've said on a number of occasions is that we believed that this was the right reform, building on the foundations of the way that dentistry is funded and provided in Scotland. And I think the other thing that's incredibly important is that we continue the dialogue with our dentists to ensure we're getting the right changes made. Whether that's on governance, whether it's on workforce, whether it's on access, and I think that's all really important. I know that, Tim, you wanted to make some comments about access.
Thank you. So it was in response to a question previously also. When it comes to access, both sustainment and improvement of access, because in Scotland we have an independent contractor model, it's the confidence of those contractors working in the sector that we have that determines, is a critical factor in access. So for me, because we've engaged with the profession throughout the development of these regulations and critically the payment system, and because we will keep engaging with them, whether it be through town halls, through my team, through the webinars that the Minister's already referenced, that will help us to build confidence in the profession that these payment measures can sustain access, because they allow those independent contractors to make good business decisions that can then promote and sustain the oral health of the population to access that critical NHS dentistry.
That's great, thanks. Dentistry is one of those areas where I think patients find it more difficult than others to raise concerns and give feedback on treatment and ongoing reforms. Is there a plan in place to ensure that people can have those voices heard, and that those ways of giving feedback, good or otherwise, are advertised for people to be able to input into the system?
I think that's a really, really good question. And the first thing that came into my head was with NHS dentistry, with more widely looking at NHS boards, there's care opinion where people can feed in their views. If I'm being honest, with regard to the way that high street dentistry, if I may describe it as that, is constructed, it's very much individual businesses, as Tim McDonnell has just referenced. But certainly, I would encourage people to use care opinion if it's if they're wanting to feed into actual NHS dentistry.
Thank you. Thanks, Convena.
Thank you. Am I going to move to David Torrance?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister, and to panel members. Around the reforms, how are we going to assist to retain and recruit new people in NHS dentistry?
Thank David Torrance for the question. It's a very wide question, and what we're doing with regard to the changes in fee structure and also the regulations is, as I've said before, to maintain and ensure we have got the sustainability of the service across Scotland. I think with regard to encouraging people into dentistry, one of the areas that we want to look at is workforce. And there has been two pretty big impacts on dentistry. One was Brexit and the more difficulty in getting dentists from out with the UK to come to the UK. And with regards to that, I have written to all my counterparts in the Four Nations and also their CDOs, and we're organising a meeting to talk about how we can improve the throughput if dentists wish to come and practice in the United Kingdom, in Scotland specifically, from our perspective. But also improving the workforce within dentistry. So, for example, there are some very highly skilled dental technicians that we would like to explore giving them more locus to see patients as well, and we're talking around the possibility of doing that. So there's a whole this isn't just one silver bullet that's going to solve it. So there's a lot of things that we are working together with, and that's why it's so important, as both Tim McDonnell and Tom Ferris have highlighted, is the connection and the discussions that we have with dentists, whether it's through the BDA more widely, but also through the NHS dentistry, Directors of Dentistry.
Thank you. And Stephanie Callaghan.
Thank you very much, Convener, and thanks for coming along this morning. So we know, Minister, that dental services have been struggling to recover to pre-pandemic levels, and that there's been a significant backlog of patients awaiting treatment. So I'm wondering how these reforms will enhance the recovery and sustainability of NHS dentistry in both the short and in the long term.
I thank Stephanie Callaghan for her question. I think that's really the nub of what these reforms are, is to ensure that we do sustain NHS dentistry in the long term. You will have received lots of emails about the sustainability or the access that people have. So we've got these reforms, but I think we also need to remember that the Scottish Government has put other grants in place. So, for example, the SDAI, which offers £100,000 for a new practice in an area, which we have been in discussions with the health boards to ensure that we're targeting that these grants in the right areas. We've also got some remote, although I don't like using that term, grant payments as well, which are really important. And the health boards, the conversations that Tom Ferris and myself have with health boards are very important as well, because they have a responsibility to look at how their dental services are being provided in their jurisdictions. And I was really pleased to hear that Borders, Dumfries and Galloway and Highland are now working together to try and encourage more dentists to come to their areas where perhaps they've had recruitment issues. But as I referenced to David Torrance, it's also about the breadth of skills within dental surgeries that we need to keep an eye on and ensure that they're supported.
Thank you. And can I just ask as well, Are there any concerns around the fact that people who are paying the part of their NHS dentistry treatment, are there any concerns that the increased costs around that are actually going to discourage people from seeing their dentist, and that that could have an impact on sustainability and early treatments?
So I think what we have to remember is that everybody under 26 gets free dentistry, and as I referenced earlier, between 20 and 25% of adults don't pay for their NHS dentistry either. I think we had to really look at how was the best way to ensure that we sustained the number of dentists and dental practices that we have in Scotland. And it was felt that a slight increase in the fees was right. These are still capped at £384. And I think I've referenced this earlier, the letters, the concern that I have been hearing with regard to dentistry is about access, and that's what we believe these changes and amendments and regulations are helping us achieve.
So just a very, very short question there then, and I do entirely appreciate and understand the logic for that there, but currently with the cost of living crisis happening, etc. too, I'm just wondering, is that something that you will be closely monitoring in case it does throw up any issues?
Most definitely. I think cost of living is kind of floods through every decision that we are making just now. So, yes, it's absolutely something that we will be keeping an eye on.
Thanks very much. Thank you.
Thank you. And can I thank the Minister and her officials for their attendance today? And we will now move on to the third item on our agenda, which is consideration of two negative instruments. The first instrument is the instrument on which we've just taken evidence from the Minister, the National Health Service General Dental Services Miscellaneous Amendment Scotland Regulations 2023. The purpose of this instrument is to make specific changes to existing regulations to support payment reform and make miscellaneous changes to the government that the government intended at the next opportunity of amendment of those existing regulations. The Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee considered the instrument at its meeting on the 12th of September 2023 and made no recommendations in relation to this instrument. And no motion to annul has been received in relation to this instrument. And I ask if members have any comments, and I'll pass to Sandesh Kohani.
Thank you. Declaration of interest as a practising NHS GP. A lot of dentists are still concerned that these changes do not address the root cause of their problems, and they do not feel that this will be enough to help sustain, especially in rural areas and deprived areas, and they don't feel that these changes will allow for the Scottish Government manifesto pledge of free dentistry to under 26 to happen. I would like to see evidence over the next year to assess the changes and also what improvement to access there has been following this.
Thank you for your comments, Mr. Kohani. They'll obviously be part of the official record now. I propose that the committee does not make any recommendations in relation to this negative instrument. Does any member disagree with this? No. Thank you. The second instrument is Health and Care Professions Council Miscellaneous Amendment Rules Order of Council 2023. The purpose of the instrument is to provide the Health and Care Professions Council with the power to increase fees charged for processing and scrutinising applications for admission to its register, for renewal of registration and for readmission or restoration to the register. It also enables the practice committees and appeals panel to hold remote hearings outside of emergency periods. The policy note states that the Health and Care Professions Council fees were previously updated from July 2021. It also states that offering remote hearings alongside in-person hearings will make it easier for some attendees to engage with the process, such as those with mobility or mental health conditions. The Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee considered the instrument at its meeting on the 26th of September 2023 and made no recommendations in relation to this instrument, and no motion to annul has been received in relation to this instrument. And I'll now pass to Sandesh Kohani, who I believe has further comments.
Thank you. And I'd like to declare my interest as a practicing NHS GP. I'd like to take this opportunity to tell the committee and to also the public that I've received a lot of email and correspondence from members of the Health and Care Professionals Council, and they are opposed to the increase in fees given the global cost of living crisis and the fact they feel the increase in fees is not justified. And there's a lot of people who are unhappy. Though in defence of the council, I do understand this is the first increase in fees for years, and they do feel that if they don't increase the fees, they might well go bust. And this is a very difficult decision, I think, that is being taken.
Thank you, Sandesh Gulhani. Again, those comments will be part of the official record of this meeting. I propose that the committee does not make any recommendations in relation to this negative instrument. Does any member disagree with this? No? OK, thank you. We'll now move into private session for a short break to allow panels to change. The fourth item on our agenda is an evidence session on the National Care Service Scotland Bill. Today we will hear from representatives of local government and integration joint boards. For this morning's session, I welcome to the meeting Eddie Follin, Chief Officer, Health and Social Care COSLA; Eddie Fraser, Chief Executive, East Ayrshire Council, representing Solace Scotland; and Professor Suman Sengupta, Director of Health and Social Care, South Lanarkshire Health and Social Care Partnership, representing Health and Social Care Scotland, Chief Officers Group. And we're going to move straight to questions, and I'll pass to Tess White.
Thank you, convener. Mr. Follin, with legal responsibility being shared between the Scottish Government, the NHS and local authorities, does this blur the lines about who is accountable when services are not delivered adequately? Thank you.
Thanks very much, Ms. White. I think it's probably to go back to where we got to with legal accountability, because we're talking about shared accountability. Now, we haven't actually worked through what that'll look like yet. So I think at the moment we're having discussions around that. So, but the intention would be that it shouldn't blur the lines at all, really. Because we're also looking at an escalation framework. So at the end of the day, you know, decisions will have to be taken jointly between NHS, Scottish Government, and ministers in terms of the delivery of social care. So, you know, from my perspective, although we don't know the detail of it, well, you know, the way that we would look at it is we should actually be clearer about how accountability is delivered.
But the buck would have to stop somewhere.
Yeah, it would, and I think we'll have to work through that in terms of the legislation. And I can understand from a committee perspective how, you know, you want to be clear about that when you consider the next iteration of the legislation. I mean, I guess we were in a difficult position initially. We had a bit of a standoff between ourselves and government in terms of the bill, and I know the committee heard evidence on that issue. So we really had to get to a place where. We had to get to a better place to take this forward, and that, you know, that agreement is between us politically at the moment is that we have a system of shared accountability. But as I say, we've not really got to the stage where we've worked that through, and I know that we're working with Scottish Government on what that will look like, and the NHS as well. So, but we would set out with the intention that, you know, we know who is responsible for the delivery, and if things go wrong, what do we do about it?
Okay, thank you. And how satisfied are COSLA and the local authorities that the new agreement has addressed the issues that the councils have raised?
Yep, I mean, I think we're in a much better place, You know, our concern had always been that there was the potential for the transfer of staff and assets and functions away from local authorities. And again, I'll not rehearse all that because I know that we've probably spoke to most committee members about it. So that's not going to happen. You know, there isn't going to be any staff transfer, there's not going to be any transfer of functions, nor is there going to be any transfer of assets. So I think we're in a much better place with government. We're working in partnership with them and the NHS, you know, which reflects that shared accountability. It also reflects the delivery at a local level as well, because that we wanted to make sure that we were, you know, we were replicating the way that decisions were made locally, and those decisions are made locally between the local authority, between the NHS and you know, and now government involved. And I think what government have kind of got out of this is that ministers will be in there in terms of that accountability. So it will be, you know, it will be a joint approach. So from our perspective, you know, at the moment we're pretty content with the direction of travel. That said, you know, a lot of the things we'll say today have not been politically agreed. That does constrain us a wee bit, you know, in terms of what we can say around the kind of negotiations. But we've got a system of negotiation in place, you know, and we're working towards, you know, making progress.
And just one final question: in terms of the accountability and the responsibility, if the assets and the staffing stays and the budgets stay within the local councils, with the local councils, then isn't there a huge concern that there is a difference, that one party will be responsible and another accountable?
Yeah, I mean, again, you know, that these are some of the conundrums that we're grappling with as we move as we move this forward. You know, so, I mean, I don't know if you wanted to, I know that Eddie will maybe want to kind of touch on the assets bit of that from a local authority chief executive perspective. But yeah, I think, again, you know, this is, these are things that we're, and I think this is, you know, one of the issues here is the complexity with which we're dealing with a lot of these issues, and it is a really kind of complex area, as you all know, and we're doing that in a really short timescale, you know, which is driven by, you know, the primary legislation. So, you know, for us, we're conscious of that, and we need to kind of be conscious of the fact that, you know, we don't want to get this wrong, so we need to deal with issues like that. But I don't know, Eddie, if that's okay, convener, sorry.
Of course. Okay.
Thanks. I think some of the questions you raised are absolutely valid around clarity, you know, around the accountability. And, you know, some of the discussions that were around is about, do you have joint accountability? And I think that then does become blurred because you're not sure. That's why when we talk about shared accountability, there should be a clarity about what is government responsible for, what is local government responsible for, and what's the NHS responsible for. So although it sounds like just a change of word from joint to shared, it's not actually, as we understand in the advice we get from the lawyers, that's a very important, you know, distinction, you know, between them, so that we are all clear. And more importantly, I suppose, people who use services and families are clear about where accountability lies. In terms of, you know, where we've got to, you know, around some of that at a national level and about retention of staff and assets, I think that is positive. If you're going to retain staff, and I think when I was previously at the committee, I was trying to describe if the staff go, then a range of assets, you know, the building they're in goes, then, you know, like, and the electric cars they drive go, and these different things there. So yeah, the one follows the other, you know, in terms of, you know, to where we are around that. But where we are just now, you know, at a national level, only works at a local level if the local arrangements allow that. So we've still to see the detail of things like ethical commissioning and the different arrangements that we'll actually see. So what does that actually mean at a local level to enable, you know, local authorities to continue to provide, you know, services and to continue to make sure that social care workers are valued in what they're paid to deliver these services. So the national is one level to get that in place, but that has to be enabled by what we do at the local level as well to make sure that it's actually practically deliverable too.
Thank you. Picking up a little bit on that theme, I'm keen to hear the panel's views on the role of the third and private sector in the governance of social care, given that we know they're responsible for over 75% of provision of the services. So should they have a place in the governance structure of the National Care Service?
Come in on that. Yeah, okay. I mean, it's absolutely crucial that we work with the third sector. You know, we know that. And we do, certainly COSLA does and others. We haven't really kind of worked through the national board and how that will look in its entirety. But I know that the minister, you know, had kind of made a commitment as well to a national advisory group in terms of how that national board will operate. And whilst we've not, as I said, convener, we've not got a political agreement on these things yet, but, you know, if that was to kind of go forward, then you would, you know, certainly our view would be the third sector would be a big part of how that's delivered. You know, they are our delivery partners. You know, we work with them on a regular basis. So it's difficult for me to envisage how they wouldn't be involved in that kind of stuff. But that's not a decision that's been made yet. But certainly, you know, on the national advisory group, there needs to be third sector and, you know, wider stakeholder involvement, including people with lived experience, in the development of how that national board will operate.
Do any of the other panel members want to offer their views on that?
Yeah, so I think we should remember already at a local level, you know, every integration joint board is required to have a strategic planning group that actually does the planning for health and care, and there's a wide range of representation on that in terms of actually doing the plans coming forward. I absolutely understand, you know, where the third and independent sector feel as, you know, second-class members of IJB boards, you know, because they don't have a vote on IJB boards. I would say, you know, in our own board, you know, in East Ayrshire, we've not had votes because we actually do a lot of work in that strategic planning group and work with consensus, you know, going through. So, but the perception is, you know, certainly that there. I think, you know, that we also need to, you know, understand, or I certainly understand, that our independent and third sector organisations on the whole, you know, employ local people to provide services to local people, and therefore they're huge, important parts of our system. And it's not just about, you know, them as organisations, it's about, you know, the people that work within the organisations. So if I can give an example, all our care homes in East Ayrshire are actually in the independent sector, but it's actually local women on the whole that actually work in them. So
staying away a bit from what I'm asking here,
okay,
which is specifically about those organisations being on a governance board. So I don't know if you're able to offer an opinion of whether you think that they should be there. I've heard the importance that you and the regard that you have for them,
yep,
but whether or not they should actually be in the room.
From our perspective, I think, you know, they should definitely be in the room. You know, like the issue comes up again about accountability, you know, in terms of one organisation taking a decision that actually has an impact on, say, the resources of another organisation. But the scale of our partnership with the third and independent sector, I can't actually understand how they couldn't be in the room to actually take, you know, decisions, and decisions that are well informed.
Simon?
Good morning. To add on that point then, so ultimately who's within the room is a matter for elected representatives such as yourselves, the Parliament, and indeed local elected members, and indeed other stakeholders within this. I would, though, concur with Eddie's point that the earlier question around accountabilities and responsibilities here aren't then just around the delivery element around this. It's as much about the responsibilities and accountabilities of the individuals who make up, whether it be the national board or indeed the local care board or whatever the version of that is going forward. So whoever has a vote within those arrangements, it should also be quite clear to the public, as well as the staff, that this is how they're held to account for decisions that they make collectively as part of those decision-making bodies. And provided we've got clarity on that, then we can move forward constructively.
Thank you. I'm now going to move to David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to panel members. Why is it local authorities provide and deliver such a low proportion of adult care services? And what would it take for local authorities or health and social care partnerships to increase the proportion of services their staff deliver directly? And could this be an effective route of ensuring consistent terms and conditions for fair work? I was a bit long-winded.
I mean, I think, you know, when we look at, you know, the range of different needs in terms of health and care, often we rely on organisations with quite specific needs, you know, skills to do that. So we do rely on partners who have specific needs in terms of dementia, learning disability, mental health. And we have many partners out there in the third and independent sector who have specific skills in terms of doing that, and they have capacity in terms of doing that across all our local authority areas to do that. So I think you'll find that, you know, often, you know, when we use you know, organisation partners, it's because of the specific skills that the partners, you know, that have around that. In different areas, you know, different local authorities have looked at, you know, the local workforce, and they've got different levels, you know, in terms of how they deliver. So some have large in-house workforce normally for older people, others don't, and they've got to commission that workforce in, and that's grown up over time. But when you get into some of the specialist areas, I think you'll find nearly all local authorities actually rely on third sector partners to actually deliver on that.
Thank you for that.
To add, Mr. Torrance, you know, there's a flexibility about the delivery, you know, from a third sector perspective as well, you know, and I think, you know, third sector organisations, as we've said, are, you know, are really valuable partners, as are the independent sector, because they provide, a vast amount of social care as well, and I think those decisions will be taken on a kind of local basis, and it will take into account, you know, it will take into account costs, but it will take into account, you know, the ability to deliver, you know, the needs of the local population, you know, and and those decisions will be taken locally. So it's quite a kind of complex picture, and some local authorities will provide more than others as well. So
can I just add, obviously, you know, the actual decision about who provides care is actually with the individual, you know, under self-directed support, you know, legislation. It's not for a local authority to decide that they're a sole provider, you know, of that. You know, an individual can either choose to go with a local authority to get it, they can choose to ask the local authority to arrange it for them, or they can choose to make their own arrangements of how they do it, or a mixture of them all. So our self-directed support legislation actually gives that flexibility to an individual to make the choices, rather than it seem as though from the top down we tell people actually how they need to get their care provided.
Thank you for that. How do you see sectoral bargaining operating across all sectors of the provision public third sector? And the reason I'm asking that is the Scottish Government's pledge of £12 an hour. How confident you are, no matter who the employer is, that that will be given to the worker?
I'll take the last bit first. And that is the £12 an hour will be passed on through local authorities to the individual sectors and organisations, as we did with the 1090 uplift as well, and in terms of sectoral bargaining, you know, there are a range of discussions going on at the moment around sectoral bargaining. We, you know, in local government, we've already got our own sectoral bargaining arrangements. I think that is something that there would be no appetite on our part to pick that up. To pick that apart or take it apart, because those are fairly established bargaining. But we're really keen to support how you can have that sectoral bargaining in the third and the independent sectors as well. So we're working with CCPS and we're working with Scottish Care around how that can be delivered. So I'm not going to put a level of confidence on that, because it's not only is it I keep talking about complex, but it's not only that complex, it's a really sensitive area in terms of pay negotiations as well. But the discussions are taking place. We're absolutely committed to getting to achieving it, and local authorities' roles and local government role in supporting those arrangements will be really important, and we're looking at different ways of doing that.
Thank you for that.
Gillian Mackay.
Thanks, Nina. How confident are you that ethical commissioning and procurement proposals for the NCS will ensure fair work principles are guaranteed for social care staff?
I suppose that's, you know, similar to the previous, you know, that answer that Eddie gave. You know, I think it is, you know, important that if we're going to have sustainable social care in the future, therefore, commissioning rather than procurement, actually commissioning and understanding the capacity required in social care. We need to understand the workforce required. We need to be able to pay them, you know, in respect of that. I think it's important that we actually see that, rather than look at, you know, sometimes look at the terms and conditions of local authority or NHS staff, and actually see they're much higher than the independent or third sector. So how do we bring the independent and third sector up to their levels so that the local women that I spoke about earlier are actually getting paid a decent wage to do that? And actually, you know, for me, you know, the ethical commissioning is making sure that the resources that we're putting into this in the wider public sector are actually going to deliver that quality of care, and actually that money is flowing through to give the capacity of care and the quality of care for people. So ethical commissioning for me is making sure we have the right capacity of the right type of skills in place, and I think the only way to do that is if we're actually paying people well.
Yeah, I wouldn't disagree with any of that at all, as you'd imagine. And again, I'm not wanting to put a level of confidence on it, but, you know, again, the commitment is there to do this. And I mean, it's a direction of travel we need to go in, you know, because we won't deal with, you know, we may talk about later on about the pressures in the system, you know, and the problems we've got with recruitment and retention unless we actually have, you know, an ethical commissioning framework like that, you know. Is there a frustration on everybody's part that it's probably a bit slower than anybody would like? Absolutely, you know, but I think some of the kind of financial constraints that we face make that difficult as well. Some of the kind of sensitivities around pay, you know, and other things make that difficult. But you know, it's definitely something that we need to do it, you know, and we need to do it, you know, as soon as we possibly can.
If I can add to that, good morning. Two other elements I'd want to pull out from that. One ties into the point Eddie just said there about funding for this. So this is only real if we can pay for it. And committee members will be very minded around the real significant challenges we have across social care and indeed healthcare in terms of funding at the moment, as indeed is the public sector and on a whole. So we need to make sure that whatever we're promising here, actually we can follow through from a funding perspective. So that's, I've suggested, a big challenge for all policymakers at all levels in terms of where we're going within the public sector. And tied into the point around ethical commissioning is that element around standards of care and quality that Eddie's also mentioned earlier with respect to this. So one of the elements that I do think is really interesting and something we really should be really grasping and embracing in terms of the discussions that we've had with government are around the national agencies here, the National Social Work Agency, and what it can do, how we can work with NES and other colleagues in terms of developing the pipeline for social care staff, social work staff. One of the things that the NHS does well, as you'll be familiar with, it's an area we're constantly working on, but nonetheless it's got a real tradition around having career structures and pathways for people when they enter at different levels. Now, increasingly, we're looking to develop as portfolio careers within healthcare. It's really important that we develop and strengthen similar arrangements within social care, and ideally get to a position where actually people are able to move across roles and deploy their skills differently, because that's just as important. Paying conditions is one aspect of this, but the other element is actually how we continue to invest and encourage people to move through their careers within health and social care effectively, and to do that with a real set of standards that provide reassurance to our communities that the care that then they're then experiencing and getting is what they need. Thank you.
I absolutely take on board the issues around funding and things, but I think there are some elements in terms of culture and other things as well within the system that maybe don't have as many pound signs beside them as some of the other pieces of terms and conditions that we talk about quite regularly. And obviously Eddie said about the number of employers and that some of them are in better places than others in terms of those terms and conditions and culture and other pieces as well. What work's ongoing at the moment to bring some of those employers who maybe are at the lower end up to the standard of others, and what continual work is going on at the moment within local authorities to push on some of these areas of work so that we're not constantly waiting for big pieces of service reform, and that we take the staff along with us at the moment who are absolutely slogging their guts out doing their jobs day in, day out.
Yeah, I mean, I'll maybe let Eddie kind of pick up on some of the kind of actual in what local authority, what I mean, sort of from a national perspective, you know, the culture bit that you talked about is absolutely crucial, you know. And, you know, I think we've had some quite challenging discussions, really, you know, both, you know, between employers, employee representatives and the sector as well, on how that's delivered. But I think it's a really good point. I think that, you know, as part of those discussions, you know, we'll be looking at, you know, what can we do now? So we've got the joint statement of intent, as you know, and you know that was signed as when the National Care Service, when the Feely recommendations first came out, you know, and part of that is that commitment to commissioning. So and what do we need to do now around the edges of that? But I'll come back to it. You know, I think part of the frustration as well has been, and you know, and just to reiterate, is that funding issue? It's at the core, but you're right. You know, we need to probably do more around the edges of that to make sure, and that's something that we'll be working with partners to do. But you know, Eddie, maybe talk a wee bit about, you know, I don't know, you know, what was on local authorities specifically.
Yeah, I mean, so I suppose there are different levels of it, aren't there? So at one level, we talk about the role of the, you know, the care inspectorate, you know, in terms of any organisation, it doesn't matter what sector, and whether it's local authority, private or independent, you know, in terms of making sure, you know, that organisations run properly. Part of the joint statement of intent, so out within the legislative process, was about improvement in social care. So there is a National Improvement Board, you know, that's been established out with that, that's jointly between local authorities and government and NHS to actually look at, you know, improvement in terms of social care and community health services, and actually both Eddie and I jointly chair that along with, you know, government. So I think there's a recognition that improvement in social care and our community services cannot wait on a legislative programme that can take a number of years, that we have to move forward out with that and actually see that as improvement and support of organisations, because again, I don't think that any of the organisations or any individuals are trying to deliver poor quality services. There'll be circumstances that they can be supported in terms of that. So I think, you know, it has to be making sure that we don't almost see improvement kicked into the long grass because of a legislative programme going on just now, that we actually focus on that improvement just now.
Great. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you. And Tess White is a supplementary.
Thank you, Convener. Just register my interest as a fellow of the Chartered Institute of Personnel and Development. My question is to Professor Sengupta. So, Professor Sengupta, you said it's only real if you can pay for it. Most staff are employed by private sector providers, in fact, 76%, and the current model outsources to the third sector, and it, the model focuses on cost and lowest price for those providers. So one of the consequences historically has been that wages are kept low. So if they're competing on price, they keep their wages low. So how does that conflict with fair work and ethical commissioning in your view, and does something significant have to change with the new model? Thank you.
Yeah, just wait. Sorry, mine's coming up red at the moment. So, is it okay for me? Sorry. I'll also apologise. I've got a bit of a croaky voice this morning. So, this is something we spend quite a lot of time thinking about locally, and I'm sure that'll be the case across all areas of Scotland. Value for money is a key aspect of our procurement processes. So, I wouldn't actually characterise it as going for the cheapest one all the time. I can't speak for all areas, but I would say it's about making value for money. And value for money then is about a balance of a number of elements. So absolutely cost is one component of it, but so is clarity of reliability or provision. It's also about the quality. And it's about the degree of flexibility depending on the nature of what you're getting. Again, as it's already been talked about today, this is a wide variety of services and supports that we're talking about. It can be highly personal to certain individuals, particularly if you're talking about very complex packages of care that will sometimes last years and require a high degree of consistency of provision for an individual. And then there's other aspects of it, like, for example, like a care home package or whatever, that can actually be done by a range of individuals, provided it's properly and well organised. So, for me, as long as we're holding on to making best use of the public pound for the citizen, that is the way that we will continue to ensure that we're making best use of that resource. And for me, that then ties into your point about ethical commissioning, because again, it comes back to making sure that you've got a workforce that are committed, that are where the incentives are in place for them to do a good job, that they're paying attention to the needs of an individual in front of them, but also we need to make sure that we're doing that in a way that we can sustain. So, again, we can, from a delivery perspective, approach this from any number of angles, but we need the resource in place in order to make sure that the range of services and supports are available to the people who need it. The more resources we've got, the more options we can provide in terms of what the nature of the contracts are that we're offering, the length of contracts, something we get from a lot of providers tied into issues of fair work, is about whether it's a one-year contract or can we not do longer. So if we've got greater stability of funding, that allows us to provide them with that sense of certainty, that allows them to provide a greater degree of clarity for their workforce around paying conditions and also other aspects related to fair work, for example, in terms of their environmental sustainability commitments as we work towards net zero. So we can't move away from the fact that funding is critical here, both in terms of the money that people get within their pocket, but also about that sustainability of service provision. Does that go some way to answering your question?
It does, just a quick follow-up. But let's say, for example, the previous committee we heard about Shetland. Let's say Shetland, and it was mentioned by the minister, was a great model. So in terms of if, hypothetically, Shetland is a great model to go for, and you've got one size fits all under the new National Care Service, then another local government will be forced to apply the model of another area, and then costs will increase. Is that a major concern, and how will it be managed?
So I'm working on the basis around the position that was agreed, the consensus position that's initially been agreed over the summer, which is, as I understand it, and has already been articulated, emphasises the need for coming up with local solutions in respect of that. So, as I understand it, from when the minister gave evidence here, and I don't want to speak for them, but it was they were highlighting the experience of Shetland. What they weren't proposing that would be applied across the piece. It's around building on the assets within a particular community, in that case Shetland, seeing what the organisational arrangements are in place that can be deployed, critically understanding the needs and priorities of the individuals who live there, being realistic about how those assets can be deployed from a logistical perspective and otherwise in terms of that environment, and then moving forward hopefully in a way that's consensual. Now, that's difficult. I mean, absolutely, that is difficult. That is part of why all of this is difficult. But we keep on coming back to the notion that social care in particular needs to be person-led. So that means we need to provide as much flexibility in the system, particularly, I would suggest, at local level, to ensure we can come up with arrangements that enable people to get person-led services, that allows it to be adapted for their particular circumstances. And again, that will vary from community, from client group to client group, depending on what the levels of needs are. Don't get me wrong, there's a lot that we need to do within Scotland about sharing of learning. Certainly that's something within Health and Care Scotland. The Chief Officer is spending an awful lot of time engaging with, sharing information, bringing in speakers to tell us what they've done, and giving a lot of consideration to how we can reflect upon our own performance to scale up better. The same thing applies across local government, health boards, and indeed other parts of the public sector. We all recognise we need to do better here, but we also do recognise that a challenge we continually get within our local areas from elected representatives such as yourselves, from local communities, is about how to make sure that the services we provide are ones which are credible and personalised to the people where they provide services to.
Okay. Now going to move to Stephanie Callaghan.
Thank you very much, Convener, and thanks for joining us this morning. And I'm really interested in co-production and regional forums. So I'd be interested, I don't know whether any of you have actually been yourselves along to any of the regional forums or whether any of your staff have been along, so it'd be really interesting to hear about any feedback and any learning from that. And also what your thoughts are on co-production and co-design and how that can achieve transformational change. Thank you.
Yeah, well, thanks very much. But certainly our staff have been along to the co-design sessions. It's interesting because one of the things that we were able to move forward with the political agreement that we came to in June was our involvement in co-design, because our leaders made the decision not to do that because we were at that point we were opposed to the approach. So it's been really good to kind of be able to get involved in that, and I know that the government have done a huge amount of work, right across, and they had the summer forums as well. I know the minister was talking to you about that, but certainly from our perspective, it's really important, that those sessions are taking place locally as well, because I think we'll have a range of voices nationally who will have a view on how things need to progress and what sort of system we need to have, and that's absolutely valid, But as far as the co-design sessions go, the aim there was to get voices that were locally, that were getting experience, you were getting the experiences of the system, how did people feel about how that was delivered now. And I think that what will be important about those co-design sessions and what came from them is that how that informs the discussions that we're having nationally, and that's the crucial bit, because I think that, and I absolutely get this, that there were people and organisations who saw the bill going in one direction, we took a position on that bill, not just us, trade unions and others. There was a wide range of views on it, and I think we really welcomed that kind of change of direction in terms of where we got to. But and I know that probably has caused a bit of concern as well amongst people, with lived experience and some of the disabled people's organisations as well, but certainly our commitment is to make sure, that whatever system we end up with, at the end of this, it's informed by those co-design sessions and by those organisations who represent people with lived experiences, interests, and people with lived experience themselves. So that's, you know, we're entirely committed to that. You know, and I think a lot of the stuff that came from the co-design sessions, you know, was really helpful. It reflects a lot of the stuff that we think around prevention, you know, and getting in early and making sure that, you know, the kind of care follows the person, that we try to achieve some kind of consistency of outcomes, you know, and if people are moving, care packages are transferred, was one of the big things we heard. So I think all of that, you know, is hugely valuable in terms of how we you know, how we take our work forward, you know, when we're in discussions with government and with discussions with other stakeholders as well.
If I could add in, so similarly, I've had staff attend the sessions. I think it's to the credit of the civil service that they've put such a degree of energy into that within a relatively short space of time. We've had good feedback in terms of what they've been sharing. The proof of the pudding, though, is in the eating here, which speaks to that point that Eddie's talked about. So we're really critically interested in terms of how the issues have all been raised through those processes then get factored into the next round of material that comes out in draft from government. There are elements of what have been highlighted that were actually quite reassuring, because it demonstrates there's still consensus around the issues that we need to do better on. There are aspects of this, though, that are also just hard. So the element around early intervention prevention, for example, all chief officers across Scotland would kind of absolutely emphasise the importance of us doing better within that space and just redesigning a system to do better in that space. But this committee, individuals around this committee, will be familiar with this having been talked about for years within Scotland. We could talk about the Christie Commission at length here, which has talked about early intervention and prevention. So the ability to translate an appetite for working within that space into doing that in practice on a consistent basis and assuring you've got the funding for doing that and transforming services so that you're able to move upstream, that's the real challenge in respect of that. So again, it's, I don't envy the task of civil servants for doing that, which is why I think the co-design process continues to be so important, is we need to recognise that we've got a series of principles here that, broadly speaking, from what I can see, most of the stakeholders can get behind. The challenge is to actually see how you can embed that within a system that delivers it consistently.
Thank you very much there. So last year the Scottish Government spoke about how co-design produced a Charter of Rights, a national complaints process, an electronic healthcare record, but not services. Are you clear at this point which aspects of the National Care Service are being co-produced or co-designed, who will be involved and when and how they will be involved?
Yeah, I think the change of direction has probably had an impact on that aspect of it. You know, certainly, you know, from a we're working with government on the single shared record, really, you know, really, really important initiative. We're working with them on a whole range of digital, initiatives as well. But from our perspective nationally, what we're trying to do at the moment is kind of come still, and I'll go back to that political agreement, but we're still trying to come to a political agreement on some of the kind of big areas, the big areas that we've talked about, like, commissioning, procurement and, funding and other aspects of it as well, you know, how those are delivered, care boards, the national board and all of that. But there are continuing discussions going on around the single shared record, around Anne's Law. These are areas that we never had an issue with from a local authority perspective initially. So it wasn't that we just said, we're not going to do that, we're not going to do anything to do with the NCS. We have been working with them on that. And I know, I know that government have been discussing this with, you know, through their co-design processes as well, as far as I'm aware. At the moment, the kind of focus for us is to make sure that we can politically get a lot of this over the line in terms of the big stuff, you know, under a fair amount of, you know, we are fairly limited timescale as well, but the discussions on the other things like Anne's Law and shared single record have been going on for a while.
Fantastic. Really, really good to hear that there's that positive commitment now and that shared focus going forward. Thank you.
Sandish Gohani.
Thank you. Professor Sengupta, you spoke about how elements of this is going to be very hard. And Eddie Folan, you said earlier that you're dealing with a very short timescale. Is this timescale not arbitrary, though, seeing as we've already had a delay to stage one? Would it not be better for this all to be ironed out in advance so that we get agreement rather than it be fast?
I guess that, Mr. Ghani, we're working with what we have, you know, and I think it's really important that we put every effort in, you know, to meet the timescales of the bill, you know, and that's what we're doing, you know, but it is really important that we get it right, you know, and that we make sure that whatever system we you know, is at the end of this is one that's effective. And, you know, primary legislation is important, you know, there are elements of what we're talking about that's going to require primary legislation. We don't want to lose that opportunity. You're right. I mean, the main thing is we get this right, you know, for people. But we will continue to work, you know, in partnership with the government, you know, on the areas that we're working on at the moment. So,
okay. And so one of the things that you said earlier was about, you know, if packages of care get transferred, if people move, and how we could get some standardisation. Do we need a co-design and a process like this? Is this not something that we should be doing right now?
Yeah, I mean, there are a range of constraints on, you know, how we deliver at the moment. I think everybody's committed to reform. I think everyone has recognised that we need reform of the social care system. There's no doubt about that. There are things that we don't do well that we need to do well, you know. And I think this what we're in at the moment is a reform process, you know, that includes legislation, you know, but there's a legislative element to that, but there is also, you know, as Eddie touched on earlier, and Suman as well, I think, about the statement of intent. So there are things that we need to be doing now, absolutely, you know, to get a statement on. We don't want to just stand still and say, well, you know, we'll wait for the legislation. That's never been our position. So I agree, you know, there are things that we need to do now. So, but I don't know if anybody wants to add to
it. I think from, you know, a solid perspective, we would be clear that we would have rather had a lot of these conversations before there was a bill. You know, so actually understanding whether children's services are in, whether justice services were in, we would rather have had the conversations before. But we accept we are where we are, and we're making progress in terms of, you know, discussions in where we are, because this really matters. It really matters to people that get services. It really matters to the people who work in both health and care. So we are where we are around that. And then understanding what needs to be in primary, you know, legislation, and making sure there's a trust that then goes on into what's going to be in secondary legislation and guidance is important in terms of where we are just now. In terms of transferability of support, again, these are the types of things that's really important. But again, some of that's down to what's available in different local areas. You know, so one area might have a lot of supported housing available, for instance, and another area doesn't. So the types of support you get in different areas change. But the outcomes for people shouldn't be able to change. People should be able to define what they want in terms of outcomes, and then need to use the local infrastructure to actually deliver that. So, as I say, when you asked about the time taken for this, I think this will take time, and I think just now we're very much in what needs to get into primary legislation, and then making sure there's a trust then. And I think that trust, you know, that extends back to the co-design, you know, question, because I think we've lost some trust, that people have lost, you know, an understanding about, as if there are rooms over there making all these decisions and we won't get a say in it, and actually, you know, emphasising to people that this is still at the framework level and that you will still get a say in how this is. But I think that's an important message that needs to get across to people, or else they will lose trust in the whole situation and all of us as partners, you know, not just government.
Thank you. And my final question, you know, you twice now I've heard we are where we are, but we aren't, because we've already had a delay. So I fail to see why we can't have another delay to get things right. But when it comes to the co-design process, when it comes to the trust, are you happy that there is enough transparency in the co-design process where not only are the things that are said going to be reported, but then the transparency of how that's amalgamated and how that's brought in to the general work that goes on afterwards?
Well, certainly from our perspective, it has to be brought in to the process. There'd be absolutely no point in doing a whole co-design process and then that doesn't inform what it is that we're going to be doing. I mean, that's, why would we do it in the first place? So certainly, from our perspective, and I'm sure from, that's why the government did it, it was to get those voices in. And I think that because they'd ran, I think I said to Ms Carlin earlier, they'd ran a whole series of sessions over, over the summer as well, to try and address some of the kind of issues and the change of direction as well. But as Eddie said, we need to make sure that we can build that trust again, because I think that change of direction has, people will be like, well, what's happened here? Why were we going this way and now we're going that way? So I think, and part of gaining that trust and rebuilding, or if we have to rebuild the trust, is to make sure that whatever happens here, as part of our negotiations, make sure that the views that have been put there are reflected in how that looks. And I think the other thing about this as well is that, one of our criticisms of the bill, I suppose, initially had been it was a framework bill and a lot of the stuff would be left for secondary legislation, a lot of the detail would be left in secondary legislation. I don't want that to be the same for, people who've put their time and their effort into, the co-design process. They need to know, how this is why we've taken this decision. Now, some of those decisions may well be taken, and it doesn't reflect the views that people have fed in. But that, that there's going to have to be a kind of trade-off with that in some ways, But certainly our view would be that that needs to be kind of the backbone of how we design this. But what we're trying to do at the moment, as I said before, is to have that kind of framework and that sort of and get that political agreement so that we can move forward. Because previously we weren't moving forward, and you'll know that as a committee.
Thank you.
And Paul Sweeney.
And thanks to the panel for their contribution so far. The Minister gave evidence to the committee prior to the October recess, and our officials confirmed to committee that the co-design process for the Charter of Rights for the proposed legislation is still ongoing. Have the panel been involved with a specific example of co-design in relation to the bill?
We have been involved in the discussions on the charter at an officer level, Mr. Sweeney. I don't want to say pretty sure, but I have to come back and confirm with you. But I think, our team were involved in at least kind of sitting in on some of the co-design sessions on the charter as well. But I know that there are ongoing discussions on the Charter of Rights at an official level.
Do you feel it's such an inherent part of the legislation and such a critical part of the ethos of how this will all operate should be formed as a product of co-design with local government as a principle?
Yeah, I think it's going to have to be, because there will be many things in a Charter of Rights that are going to have implications for the delivery of services, and potentially, whether that could be structural or whether that would be, financial or whatever it would, you're never going to realise those rights if you don't have the infrastructure and the kind of resources in place to deliver them. Mm. So absolutely, I know Eddie will have a view on this, but we want to be involved in that, and again, we need to be clear, what people's expectations are. Now, we have expectations from the co-design process, and absolutely rightly, but we also have to, and this isn't making excuses about money, we also have to make sure that, that we deliver on those expectations from people, but we need to have the kind of resources and other things to do that. But Eddie, I don't feel like I had.
You've touched on some of it. I mean, clearly the independent review of adult social care focused a lot on human rights, and the discussion with people who use services and family carers, again, focuses on human rights. So I think the Charter has to reflect some of that. So I think the charter does have to come from, so what are the regional forums saying? And once the regional forums are there, I think then there is a place for, you know, local government and national government to actually say, this is what we've been asked for, how do we, you know, like, turn that round and actually give it back to people and say, is this really what you're saying to us? Does this really reflect the aspirations in terms of, you know, human rights? And if some of that is within a framework of what we can do when, I think that's fair enough. But I think it's really important, you know, when I spoke about that trust, that if we're out asking people in the regional forums and people have, you know, aspirations following, you know, the independent review of adult social care, then that's what's actually written down there, and people can actually see their aspirations in that charter in terms of what they can expect for that. So I do think there's a role for us in local government in respect to that. I think it has to be at the right time to make sure that what we're looking at is what people have actually said to us.
Okay, thanks.
If I could add to that, one of the interesting challenges, I use that word a lot, challenges in respect to this, is also about that reform piece that we've talked about here. And Eddie's talked about this, particularly when we were talking about packages of care. So for me, one of the interesting elements around a Charter of Rights is to think about that rights in terms of outcomes, rather than necessarily activities or processes, in some sense structures. Now, that's a big shift, and it does talk to that within the independent review, around how we move from essentially a system in almost essentially of quasi-entitlements, to actually thinking about how can we make people as independent as possible, how can we enable them within their communities. And again, some of that does tie into the feedback that's been received to those processes and others, that people wanting to be as independent as possible. So that is also one of the points we said earlier on, was about the culture and the ethos around social care and social work. So it's about how we can bring that ethos and that feedback that we hear continuously from community voices and others into that kind of charter. So it is less about you are entitled to X and Y and Z product, and more about we will work together to get you to this level of independence or this level of outcome that you can enjoy within your life. That's, again, really tricky, but that would strike me as being slap bang in terms of what Christy was talking about, absolutely in terms about a human rights approach to social care, social work, and indeed healthcare. And indeed, if we're being person-led, again, a focus on outcomes would be crucial here.
I appreciate that, and you know, please do keep us updated in terms of your co-design activity and whether you feel it as being as useful and as sufficient. Just also wanted to just ask about the Charter of Rights. Once it is codified and hopefully to a satisfactory standard, do you feel that this should stand part of the bill itself and be on the face of the bill in principle?
I would have to come back to you on that, because I would need to, you know, go back and kind of check where we are with it, to be honest, Mr. Sweeney. You know, but again, what I say, you know, if we're going to have a Charter of Rights, you know, it needs to have the strongest possible effect. Would be my view.
Okay, thank you for that. Okay.
Thank you. I'm now going to move to Evelyn Tweed.
Thanks, convener. Good morning, panel, and thank you for all your answers so far. It's been illuminating as ever. My first question is to Eddie Folan. Eddie, you have been very positive about the government's further engagement, you know, what happened over the summer. Do you feel that the bill is now going in the right direction? Do you feel that now some consensus is being agreed and that we can move on positively?
Well, I mean, that was the whole point of the agreement that we had on the 30th of June, you know, was because if you think about where we were, you know, we weren't moving forward, you know. So we genuinely, you know, appreciated the change of direction from government and in terms of where we were going. And I think, it, you know, we've been over the summer period and up to now, we've continued, you know, to have fairly intensive negotiations around a whole range of, kind of, as you've seen here, a whole range of really complex issues. So that is moving, that's moving forward, you know, and we're moving forward with that. You know, I did say, you know, that the timescales are extremely, extremely challenging in terms of the complexity of the issues that were, that we're addressing. There's no doubt about that, you know, but we remain committed to moving forward on the timescales that we've got at the moment. Sorry, dear.
So, I mean, if I can add with Eddie's positivity, if I put my scepticism in, you know, a wee bit around that. And this goes back to, you know, the first we saw of the current bill was the day the bill was published. You know, like, so, and that involved a huge part of the services that your local government are responsible for and, you know, like that I'm responsible for managing. So although we have worked well, you know, in terms of looking at how we can bring forward further proposals for our politicians, both at local and national government, to consider, you know, like when we see what that actually is, it will be, and how much we're actually engaged in seeing what the reform of the bill, you know, between stage one and stage two is. I suppose I'll feel more certain about that, you know, given that. And that is back to the, you know, like, only seeing a bill that actually, you know, had such a big impact on local government, the date was published, doesn't give a high level of trust, and actually the work that we've done has to rebuild that trust so that the next time we see an iteration of the changes that's coming to the, you know, the legislation, that we feel that really included in terms of that.
So I'll try and find a middle ground in respect of that. So civil servants certainly have been engaging with the chief officers group regularly. We appreciate seeing them in respect of this. Eddie's point is still well made in terms of when the timing of some of the announcements are. We are public servants. We are here. One of our roles is to be able to provide expert advice, whether it be to members of our IGBs, local elected members of all persuasions, the health boards that we're part of, or indeed our constituency MSPs on issues such as this. So we're available there as a resource, both in terms of our understanding of the running of the services, what the needs of our local populations who we have responsibilities for, but also because we frankly are experts in different aspects of our field. So we are keen to contribute to this process, not just because this is a vital element of legislation and a significant area of reform for Scotland, but also because we want to help get it right. And actually, we've got a massive amount to contribute to getting it right. So I'm hopeful and encouraged that our civil service colleagues will continue to engage with us on that basis, and very much look forward to ministers continuing to lean into our advice and expertise alongside all the other voices that they are listening to and paying attention to.
And do you have any insight into whether the recent changes in access to funds for unpaid carers have made a difference? And I don't know if Eddie Fraser would like to come in.
Do have any insight to it? I don't have any, you know, like data or anything to sort whether it makes a difference. I think, you know, like, to be honest, we would need to see significant changes, you know, like, to the funding, you know, like, to unpaid carers, I think, for us to see it, you know, like, make a difference. I think we need to try and, you know, like, support, you know, like, people who use services and unpaid carers to actually see what their aspirations are around some of this. The resources, you know, that we, you know, that unpaid carers receive are still at a low level, if I can say, you know, in terms of the recognition of the work there. And obviously these are, you know, the Scottish Government present additional resources, you know, to support, and absolutely, you know, recognise that. You know, but working with our local carer centre, we need to make sure that there's resource going there. So I totally welcome, you know, resources that go there for that. But to actually make them into life-changing resources, I think we were talking about significant changes in terms of the resource that went to unpaid carers.
Yeah, I mean, I certainly agree with what Eddie said. And you know, we certainly are... you know, we get representations from, you know, unpaid carers and organisations representing them as well, who would absolutely concur with that. You know, there does need to be more resource put in, you know, to supporting them, and you know, and we also kind of, you know, need to kind of guarantee sufficient capacity in the system to support unpaid carers as well, because, you know, the role that local authorities and health and social care partnerships have got, and I assume we can talk about that, you know, and supporting them, you know, is crucial, but it is also stretched, you know, and we absolutely recognise, you know, I mean, how we would, you know, how without the role that unpaid carers play, it would almost be impossible for the system to operate at all, in many respects, because it's that important. But we do need to make sure that we've got the kind of capacity to support them, and that comes to things like rights to breaks as well. But Sumina, I know you'll be much closer to that than me.
Yeah, happy to pick up the baton. Morning. So in terms of the other aspects that I would tease out, one is that point around stretch capacity. So as you'll be well aware, we do have a massive workforce challenge, a supply challenge in terms of social care, social work and the infrastructure around it at the moment. So that's, and to some extent, this also ties into the earlier point I was asked about improvement support within the independent sector. So if I look within my area, we are massively stretched thin in terms of our ability to engage in all of these areas. We want to, we've got the networks in place, but it's because of the levels of demand, it's getting harder and harder and harder. And some of that is, frankly, about money. I know I keep on saying it, but we have massive funding shortfalls to deal with, as you'll be familiar with, but also our ability to recruit the staff because in terms of the ability to fill vacancies and also then have the time for that staff group to be developed and grow. So that's a massive change that we're looking for taking forward, and that's true across all areas. But it presents challenges then in terms of the kind of supports we're able to provide in the here and now for groups such as carers. Care centres are massively important then in respect of that. That's why it's so important that we make sure we've got local arrangements in place that make sense for different carers in different communities. Again, one of the points was said around the Shetland example. And that's why we need to be very wary of one-size-fits-all arrangements, that there will be different histories, different sets of assets, different preferences, different geographies that we need to be familiar with. And again, not just around the care centres, but I would suggest also our third sector interfaces and other key groups help us as a system to work effectively there and to understand better what our local carers need, accepting that there's a whole range of different carers we're talking about. So again, there's no homogenous groups here. We're increasingly seeing people who are in their older ages caring for elderly relatives. We also need to be very familiar with young carers and their increasing demands and challenges for them, and how we can make sure we can properly support them at all stages. So as our understanding of the sophistication of these issues increases, so then is the challenge on us to be able to have the capacity to come up with these personalised solutions for these. Money's part of it, absolutely, but it's also about having the flexibility and frankly the time at a local level to engage properly. The question we said earlier, we've had quite a discussion here today about co-design. Those principles, I believe, strongly apply to how we work with our carers to make sure that we're able to co-design arrangements that, again, are sustainable, that are realistic in terms of the supports that people know they can get from us, but also enable carers to support themselves and each other as far as possible. For some individuals who've got care responsibilities, they are looking for a lot of support, quite understandably. But there are other carers, as you'll all know from your constituency work, who actually maybe just need a bit of a help at a certain point in time and then just need essentially the state to back off and let them get on with it. And again, that's why personal conversations, a person-led approach is so important here.
Thank you. And Tess White.
Thank you, Convener. If I can go back to Professor Sengupta, please. So you said earlier, Professor, that it's only real if you can pay for it. And then we've talked about this balance between one size fits all versus variety. Now, the one size fits all is a lower cost model. When you add variety, you add complexity and you add cost. You can't have the both and. And I realise it's a dilemma. So we started off with the NCS talking about one size fits all. We've now moved completely to a different model, could say a fudge, but it's like, oh yes, we'll variety, we'll individualise. But that's a huge cost.
So what's your question?
My question is, you can't have both. Your point, which is, it's not real if you can't pay for it, but then the new model talks about variety, individual needs, compared to the one-size-fits-all, which is a low-cost model.
Absolutely. So I would hope that, again, as the bill progresses in the approach, and I think this is reflected in some of what Eddie Follin's already said, in effect, what we're looking at is a continuum. And we're looking at a continuum that will vary from different groups that we provide care for. So there'll be some needs that can be met on a fairly standardised approaches. There are others which require a high degree of individualisation. So we need to be much more sophisticated, I would suggest, about how we're articulating this as we move forward. So it's, we move away from talking about our population as being homogenous, because it's not, in the same way that we need to talk about our social care services in terms of this full span of what they deliver, rather than, again, just a single banner headline. But that's the challenge around the world we live in at the moment, and it'll be a challenge going forward about how to get the right balance. And there's debates for, and I don't envy you the challenge, for policymakers such as yourselves to actually work out what is the right level of elements that need to be managed and get your best value to national level. What are the elements which are best dealt with at a local level? What are the best areas that could be progressed at a neighbourhood level? And obviously that falls into other aspects of the Community Empowerment Act and other legislation that's around. But those are the challenges I would suggest for any area of public policy development in Scotland at the moment, but particularly in terms of health and social care, that we need to actually be more nuanced in our thinking in respect of, rather than a somewhat binary option between one size fits all and flexibility. The other thing I think is really important for us to recognise as we do that is there are clearly areas that, so it's already been alluded to, that we are working on that we could see value from being done more nationally. So some of that would be to do with national standards being set and agreed around that, elements to do with workforce development, the professional support for our social care and social work workforce, greater understanding and recognition of what they do, work around national campaigns. I'm conscious that one of the big elephants in the room is around our winter pressures, because that goes to the point that was raised earlier about the time aspect here. So we like working and living in a democracy, so we'll work with whatever time scale the Parliament deems appropriate for this, as in the same way we would approach it for our within local government. But we're also doing all this work as we stand down the barrel of what's going to be another tough winter, having come out of what was already the worst winter on record, that itself followed what we thought at time was the worst winter on record. So we need to be really thoughtful about where we prioritise our efforts, and if there are areas that we can do better nationally, to have the humility to say, you know what, that would make sense to do it at a national level. Certainly some areas around procurement that we could look at nationally more through the Scotland Excel model. And I'm sure if you had a conversation with colleagues from Scotland Excel, they would talk to you about a range of areas where actually, if we had the instruments in place, we could do that work better. By the same token, though, there are other aspects around our funding, for example, where if we had greater flexibility at a local level how to use that resource, then we could probably act in a much more agile fashion and be, again, much more personalised for local communities.
Thank you. Thank you.
And we'll move on to our final theme, and Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Convener. We have had notes that delayed discharge to the National Health Service last year cost £190 million. So clearly a big opportunity cost, and a lot of that is to do with the lack of efficient integration with social care and indeed hospice care. Do you feel that local authorities are receiving sufficient financial resources to deal with social care inefficiencies in the here and now?
Well, I mean, there are always challenges with the financial package that we've got. We know that, you know, many, you know, so we can talk from a health and social care perspective about the, you know, the deficits that many of them are carrying. So, from our perspective, you know, and COSLA have been clear about that, you know, that we do need more resource. But, you know, a lot of the issues around, delayed discharge are, as we've talked about before, is about the recruitment and the retention of staff, you know, and what staff get paid, you know. But it's not just about social care, you know, when it comes to delayed discharge. You know, we need to be thinking about a whole system approach to tackling that. That's from primary care right through to social care as well, you know. And often I think we've been quite clear, you know, that, you know, the social care system isn't there just to support the health service. You know, it is a whole system of care from GPs right through to care homes and to care at home as well. So there are financial issues, there are recruitment and there are retention issues. It's about flow through hospitals. You know, it's about conveyance by ambulance. You know, it's about accessibility of GP and primary care services. You know, it's about making sure that you get your discharge processes in hospitals absolutely right. You know, it's about having a planned date of discharge. And it's about, working, and there are a range of issues around discharge without delay. You know, and then there are other issues as well about, we've got adults with incapacity. There are, there are lots of people who are kind of stuck because of the kind of arrangements around that. So from a COSLA and a national perspective, you know, we need to work to support local areas in that, but we need to make sure that, we're absolutely looking at this from a whole system perspective and not just one end. And I know that both next to me have got kind of views on that as well.
So I'll take that up. As Eddie says, delayed discharge is about flow through our system, but I'd like to take a step back from that to begin with. So just for avoidance of any confusion or doubt here, we don't want individuals to be delayed unnecessarily within hospitals. It's not good for the individual themselves in terms of deconditioning, in terms of their ability to kind of get back into their lives and be with their families. So that is not an attractive proposition for anybody. And that is one of the reasons why our systems, our services spend so much time, hours and hours and hours every week, trying to see how we can get people home at the best time. I would suggest, though, that focusing on delayed discharge as a singular measure of success of our health and care system is problematic. I feel strongly that we need to think about, as Eddie says, that entire system, and in fairness to government and civil service colleagues, the National Hospital Occupancy and Delayed Discharge Plan does reflect the necessity of a totality of approach, very much around the principles of discharge without delay. In other words, how do we reduce length of stay for everyone who's within a hospital? Depending on the year you're in, and I've seen some data around this, which I'm happy to share, that over the course of the pandemic, average length of stays within our hospitals went up by one day. If we were to move our length of stay down to the pre-pandemic levels, you would see a massive impact in terms of our occupancy levels across the piece. Those tie into then people turning up at our ED departments. Well, why is that in higher numbers at various points in time? We need to ask about why. That's to do with the flow through the hospitals themselves to make sure that colleagues within those areas are properly supported to work in different ways, but also have sufficient staff on hand. It absolutely is then about the discharge process, but also making sure that we're only providing packages of care to those people who need it the most. I feel very strongly, as indeed my counterparts do, in this notion of realistic care. So again, committee will be familiar with this from the Chief Medical Officer's approach to realistic health. The same approach can be provided to care. So we shouldn't be providing packages of care to people who don't need it. And we should be providing it in such a way that enables them to be as independent with their lives as possible. That's one of the reasons why, for example, the home first approaches, which have been rolled out across Scotland, are so important, because that's about providing wraparound care to those people who need it the most, so that you can provide support to them with as the core supports that they need, but no more than that. Because the more support you provide, the more deconditioning you potentially provide to that individual, but also it's less resource available for other people, which means you look after less people. So that requires a reform across that entirety of that process. But again, delayed discharge is actually a relatively small percentage of the people who move through our hospitals. The vast majority of people who are discharged from our hospitals don't require complex packages of care, and the vast majority of people are discharged effectively. There is a big challenge, though, around thinking about that totality of the system capacity. So we could have I'm sure there'll be other times this committee has met and discussed in length around primary care capacity, the capacity of the hospitals, etc. So you can look at these issues in isolation. And also then in terms of the messaging that goes out, and that speaks to Eddie's last point here, that social care is not there to essentially provide support to healthcare. And I say that as somebody who is, if I put aside the hat I'm wearing here today, who's both an executive director of a territorial board, as well as having responsibilities for the Council for the Delivery of Social Care as part of an HSCP. My staff, our staff who work within social work and social care, don't join that group of staff, that profession, to help out hospitals. They do it to help out people who need it within our communities, in their homes, and some of whom are in our hospitals. They increasingly work well with our healthcare colleagues, including our colleagues within hospitals, for whom many of them are based in terms of our hospital-based social work teams. But nonetheless, it's really important that we put out a message strongly to our social care and our social work workforce that they're valued for who they are and valued for what they bring themselves, rather than suggesting that the only credit that they bring to the system is somehow to do with whether a delayed discharge figure has gone down or not. And again, I say that on the basis that we all want to see delayed discharge coming down. However, there are other measures of value within the system that we need to pay attention to. Last thing, though, I would agree with you about the money. We need the resource for doing that. And part of the reason for saying that we need the resource for doing that is because, as Albert Scotland has highlighted, IGBs across the colonies are running significant recurrent deficits. Most of us, to greater or less extent, are able to balance our books this year, and some aren't, and are planning to do that into next on the basis of non-recurrent monies. That is not sustainable. We know that's not sustainable. Our external auditors have told us that's not sustainable. We are having then to all go into processes looking around how we cut our cloth accordingly right now. So in addition then to dealing with the winter pressures that are in front of us, we are also having to think about significant service reform we're having to take forward, given the significant cost increases we're having to see because, for example, of inflation and what that means in terms of the actual real terms around of resources available to us. That wasn't a challenge we had to the same extent last year or indeed the year before, but it is a very real challenge here and now.
Okay. I appreciate that outline and the complex interfaces between the acute hospitals and social care settings, and I think that's helpful. And of course, maybe the fixation on delayed discharges because it's a clear metric as opposed to, say, avoidance of hospital admission, which is a harder thing to quantify in a firm number, and that's a fair challenge back. What I would highlight back, though, is that Scotland's acute hospital expenditure is probably amongst the highest in the OECD relative to the overall healthcare system. So how do we pivot that back towards a more sustainable ratio that's more in line with OECD averages? How will this proposed health and social care integration through the National Care Service help design processes, improve processes, improve that integration to pivot the system away from the acute hospitals into the more community settings?
I think if we go back to what we were speaking about earlier around, you know, like charters are right. So Shuman's right to talk about, you know, where we can be, you know, just now. But we spoke about the importance previously about prevention. You know, we've spoke about, you know, the human rights that come out of the, you know, independent review of adult social care. And actually, you know, that nearly £200 million that's spent within the acute hospital, if it was actually spent within the community to actually deliver things differently, could maybe have much better outcomes for people, you know, like, rather than that. But you're absolutely right. What's the trick about how we actually move that money, you know, like across? And that's something that we've not achieved. That's what the 2014, you know, Act, you know, actually called set aside. And actually within that, there was always the plan that if the current IGBs were able to plan differently for the community, then you were able to draw money down, you know, in terms of doing that. That's not really worked. And it's not really worked because the continued pressures that there actually is in delivering in the acute side, there has never actually been any money to release to come down. But the core of this, if this legislation is going to, you know, make a difference, and if it's going to follow on, you know, not just from in terms of the independent review of adult social care, but, you know, back to self-directed support in the region, it's about how do we spend money in the right place to actually get the best effect for people. And actually, you know, I was 7 years as a chief officer in IGB, totally understanding that, you know, the day-to-day, you know, pressures around that. We all absolutely accept and assume and say that leaving people in hospital for lengthy times that actually sees their health deteriorate is not what anybody, you know, wants. So there is a challenge to us all about how do we make sure the money moves to the right place to do that. And it's something, you know, right from the 2014 Act, to be quite frank, we've not achieved at this time. And you can see that's just because there's not enough money overall in the system, which would be, you know, like one, you know, argument around that. And you can also challenge us about where is the money in the system and how do we move that as well.
Thank you. Can I thank the panel for their attendance this morning? and for the evidence that they've given the committee, which I'm sure we'll find very helpful. At our meeting next week, we'll be taking further evidence as part of the committee's ongoing Stage 1 scrutiny of the National Care Service Scotland Bill. And that concludes the public part of our meeting today.